Good morning to everyone. My name is Bob Chapman, and I have the pleasure to be serving as president of the Lynchburg City Schools Education Foundation, and I welcome each of you this morning. This is the sixth annual breakfast of the with the superintendent, and it's great to see a large crowd here today out in support of Lynchburg's public schools. The Lynchburg City Schools Education Foundation is honored to host this breakfast with our school superintendent, Dr. Larry Massey. This event is a unique opportunity for local business and community leaders to meet with school administrators to learn more about the Lynchburg City Schools. We are happy to have so many of you here today. As a resident of this community and employee of one of our local businesses, I know that strong public education is important to our families, imperative to business, and critical to the health of our community. Our schools impact our businesses, and our businesses impact our schools. Through tutoring, internships, mentoring, and other volunteering partnerships, the business community offers valuable resources to our school division and gives support to our students. Likewise, the school division impacts our businesses as well as the overall economic health of our community and our region. Strong public schools provide an educated workforce, which plays a role in business recruitment and retention. Strong public schools and school spending positively impacts economic development in a number of ways, including business site selection, labor location decision. After all, people don't want to relocate to a community that does not offer a strong school division. Quality of public schools also directly influences residential property values. The Education Foundation recognizes and values the symbiotic relationship between our schools and the community. For over 25 years, through the commitment and financial investment of Lynchburg businesses and individual donors, the Education Foundation has been able to offer financial support above and beyond public revenues to the Lynchburg City Schools for identified student, faculty, and school needs. Through your generosity, we were able to do the following. Offer teacher grants. This academic year alone, we awarded 43 grants totaling over $56,000 for innovative programs in the classroom. Stock the Tools for Schools warehouse, where teachers shop free for classroom resources, rewards, and incentives. Offer student scholarships for college-bound seniors and dual enrollment students to help remove the roadblock to an advanced education. Recognize our top graduating scholars from each high school, reinforcing their commitment to academic success. And last but not least, work with our community to advocate for public education in our community and our city. We couldn't do any of this without you. Without your commitment and understanding of the importance of our public schools. The generous support from today's sponsors, coupled with your interest in attending this program, is a sure sign that public education is valued and alive and well in Lynchburg, Virginia. I want to acknowledge our very generous lead sponsors for today's program, BB&T, Centra, Fleet Laboratories, Piedmont Community Health Plan, and Verizon for making this event possible. Let's give these lead sponsors a hand, please. In addition, we'd like to thank our table sponsors, Arriva, Bank of the James, Candler Oil, Central Virginia Community College, Colonial Brokerage House, Drs. Tim Corville and Joy Hilliard, Dominion 7 Architects, the Education and Research Foundation, Genworth Financial, Elena Edwards, Genworth Financial, Legal and Compliance Department, J.E. Jamerson and Sons Incorporated, Lynchburg Academy of Medicine, Lynchburg City School Board, Lynchburg College, Ellen Nygaard and Judy France, R.R. Donnelly, Roselle and Elliot Shule, Scott Insurance, Westover Dairy, Wiley Wilson, and last but not least, Wood and White Investment Advisors. Let's give the table sponsors a hand, please. This roster of support, I think, speaks to the depth of education our business community has to our public schools. Thank you to all of our sponsors for your commitment to our schools and our children, our programs, and our students. I also want to thank Ken Guerin, president of Lynchburg College, for hosting us on this beautiful campus this morning. Our keynote address today will be delivered by Meg Smith. Meg was Lynchburg's 2011-2012 Teacher of the Year and Virginia's 2012 Teacher of the Year, and we very much look forward to hearing her remarks. Thank you to Julie Doyle and her committee for developing today's program. I'd like to now call up Julie Doyle, president of the Education and Research Foundation and trustee for the Education Foundation, for our invocation. Enjoy your morning.
Good morning. As we gather today to celebrate excellence in the Lynchburg City Schools, let us take a moment to reflect on the following Buddhist proverb. If a seed of a lettuce will not grow, we do not blame the lettuce. Instead, the fault lies with us for not having nourished the seed properly. Loving God, we gather together this morning, mindful of our common mission to nourish the seeds that are the students of our Lynchburg Public Schools. Some of us may work most closely with our students on a daily basis as teachers and staff. May our efforts provide rich soil for our students to grow. Others of us are charged with the work of oversight and administration. May we serve as needed water to help sustain the soil. Still others of us represent the business and civic community who partner with our educators. Like warm sunlight, may we provide essential support so that the seeds may bear great fruit. No matter our titles or our roles, our work or our responsibilities, we are all in this together. May we be fully united in our common mission to plant, nourish, and sustain a garden of teaching excellence in which the seeds of all our students may flourish and prosper. Amen.
Good morning. My name is Charlie White, and I'm the chairman of the Lynchburg City School Board. On behalf of the entire school board, I'd like to thank you all for taking the time to attend this morning to celebrate our public school system. And a special thank you, echoing what Mr. Chapman said earlier, both to our sponsors this morning, which are, you know, you all are just tremendous with your generosity and support of this event, and to the Education Foundation and the Foundation's board for their ongoing support of our students and teachers. As a business owner myself, I can tell you that your example to the rest of the community in support of public education is vitally important, and it is deeply, deeply appreciated by all of us. This morning, I've been asked to offer some comments on behalf of the school board, and some of you may be aware, I can tell you the last several months have been pretty eventful ones for the Lynchburg City School Board. We've had a lot on our plate. We are in the midst of a major transition in leadership, and just to give you an idea, since May of 2011, and I'll leave some things out, but just some highlights, we've welcomed a new chief financial officer to the division, and Mr. Anthony Beckles, who I believe is here this morning. Some point not long after that, we bid farewell to Dr. Paul McKendrick, who is our superintendent of 6 years. We hired a fantastic interim superintendent in Dr. Larry Massey, and I'll be introducing him shortly. We hired a national search firm and engaged in a multi-month comprehensive national search for our next superintendent of schools. In December, that search process concluded with us naming Dr. Scott Brabrand as our next superintendent of schools, and he will take office on April 1st. So there's been a heck of a lot going on. Periods of change for any organization can be very uncomfortable. And I'm sure that has been the case for our organization at one time or another. Your school board has attempted to use this as an opportunity to get better, and we believe we've done so. In doing so, we have relied heavily on some of our key partners. And if I may, I'd like to take just a moment to recognize, certainly won't be able to recognize everyone, but want to recognize some key entities that have helped us through this critical period for public education in Lynchburg. We've been extremely fortunate to have the unwavering support of our city manager and his capable staff in many areas in recent months. City staff's contributions are too numerous for me to attempt to itemize here this morning, but I would like to take this opportunity to again formally and publicly thank Kim Payne for his capable leadership. I think Kim is here this morning, or I hope so. As I mentioned before, I work in the business world, and I often hear people talk about the need for the public sector to operate with greater efficiency and to, you know, as they say, you know, government needs to operate more like a business. That's something you hear in business circles a lot. Well, as a member of the business community myself, who's had the opportunity to witness Mr. Payne's work firsthand, I can tell you this is an individual who could certainly run my business, and I hope my business partner doesn't mind me saying that. He could certainly run ours. But, you know, we've got a lot of members of the business community here today, and I'll just tell you from my perspective, he could run yours too. So, Kim, thank you for everything you do for us. Also, during this critical period of transition, the school board is deeply, deeply appreciative for the collaborative spirit that has reemerged with our colleagues on City Council. We've seen that on a number of levels, but nowhere has this been more evident than in the recent work of the Heritage High School Task Force. Task Force Chairman Michael Gillette and our Vice Chairman Al Billingsley, who is on our school board, I feel set a very important tone and example in their collaborative leadership in taking on this vitally important challenge for the future of education in our city. Frankly, their leadership and example has renewed my sense of optimism about our ability to meet our future challenges together, so I thank you both. Your school board is optimistic about the future of education in Lynchburg. One reason we're optimistic is because we believe we've identified a dynamic, energetic, and visionary leader in Dr. Scott Brabrand as our next superintendent. Some members of the business community here might be interested to know that Dr. Brabrand has had a successful stint in the private sector in the telecommunications industry before he entered the education field. In his career in the Fairfax County Public Schools, he's risen quickly through the leadership ranks to the role of assistant superintendent. He has moved the needle, so to speak, with quantifiable gains in student achievement in each step of his career. His passion for Lynchburg and the potential for our school division has your school board very, very excited, and we can't wait to introduce Scott to you in April when he gets here. I know we're here today to celebrate public education, but I wouldn't be doing my job as a school board chairman if I didn't take this opportunity to share with you that for all the things we're optimistic about, we are deeply concerned about our fiscal outlook. Obviously, if we're going to preserve this community asset that we have in our public school division, we have to make every effort to be as operationally and fiscally efficient as possible. Under Dr. Larry Massey's leadership as interim superintendent, we are literally turning over every rock in search of operational savings. Your school board is determined to find solutions because we have to. We don't have any other choice. But particularly to my business colleagues here today, I would respectfully request that perhaps this year more than any other, you take a hard look and carefully consider the city manager's budget proposal that he presented on Tuesday night. Keep in mind, I'm not suggesting to you what I think you should think. I'm suggesting to you that your engagement and investment in this process, I think this year is absolutely critical. And I hope you'll consider what's at stake here for the future of our community, because frankly, we're in a very, very difficult situation. And I work in business, so I know it's tough everywhere. You don't need to remind me of that. And please consider where we might be today if in years past our business community had not made supporting public education a top priority. We've got a number of people in this room who, one of the reasons why your school board has something worth working on and fighting for is because of their efforts in the past through difficult economic times. So thank you for this opportunity to share my thoughts with you this morning. Thank you for everything that you're doing to support public education in Lynchburg. I'm gonna turn it over to Dr. Larry Massey now. For those of you that haven't had an opportunity to meet Dr. Massey, he's only going to be here through March 31st, and I would encourage you to take advantage of any opportunity you have to interact with Larry. He's been with us since August the 1st. I've been truly blessed in my life to be around some really, really remarkable leaders. Larry Massey ranks near the top of the list. Not only is he a shrewd business, fiscal, and operational manager, but his love for children is palpable and it guides his day-to-day decisions. Dr. Massey, from August 1st through today, has made us better every single day. And we have a good school system today, and you're going to hear more about that from Meg Smith later and hopefully from Dr. Massey. But your school board is committed. We believe we should have the best school division in the Commonwealth. And at some point in the future, we're going to get there. And I think at that point, we'll be able to look back and see that the seeds of greatness were sown during Larry Massey's interim tenure. So please welcome Larry Massey to the podium.
Well, my goodness, if you put this kind of breakfast on for the interim, I can't imagine what it would be when you get a real superintendent. I want you to know what an honor it has been. It has been the signature honor in my career to work in Lynchburg for these 8 months almost now as your interim school superintendent. We have an absolutely great school system, and you have an opportunity, I think, under the leadership of Dr. Brabrand, to even be greater. But on a personal note, it has absolutely been the greatest honor I've ever had just to be with you and to be around you. The greatness in this room has lifted my boat, and I want you to know what a thrill it's been. To have been here. We're working hard on this FY13 budget. We're proposing a budget to present to our school board on the 20th and then to the city council on the 27th, after we probably meet two or three more times in between. So to put it in a nutshell, I intend to light the fuse and then throw it to the school board and then head east on 460. I started the process thinking I'm going to make decisions as if I have to own them. I'm trying hard on that. We are going to do the right thing, and we are going to preserve what's going on in the classroom to the best of our abilities. I want to second what our chairman said about Kim Payne and City Council. The best thing I did when I came here the first day was I went to see Kim Payne and told him, "Look, Mr. Payne, I need you a lot more than you need me." I thought honesty would be the best policy, and that was the best thing that's happened to me, because Kim took me under his wing and he's told me the truth every time I've talked to him. And you know, telling the truth is a powerful thing. It'll confuse your enemies and confound your friends. But it sure is nice when it comes to money to just be told, "Here's what I'm recommending. Now go make do." And Mr. White is not quite as pushy as I can be at times. I want to tell you what to think. Go out and support Mr. Payne's budget, please. We appreciate all the efforts that Mr. Payne and City Council have done to support us. And when I came here, I thought I was working for the school board. I ended up working for H. Carey. With the support, the school board supported it. So I had to do it, and he asked us to do an efficiency study, and I'll have to say, I pretended I wanted to do it. It just about killed us, but it was a great thing to do, and we have discovered some real savings as a result of that. And I just want to say I appreciate being overworked, H. It's my pleasure, before I introduce Meg Smith, to introduce the Lynchburg City Schools Education Foundation. I'm going to ask you to stand in just a minute. I want you to know I've worked with three other education foundations. I've never seen a foundation that is as active and that is involved and is as effective as this foundation. And I'm going to tell you a good reason why. It's because of Jody Gillette. The only thing I don't like about Jody is she's not full-time. She is an amazing person and a great planner and a great implementer. Recently, we had a very unfortunate thing happen at Payne with some water damage we had. I didn't get turned around before the Education Foundation was making a donation to the school to help us recover from that without even being asked. That's the kind of proactive support this foundation is providing our school children. I just think that's amazing. So thank you, Jody. But at this time, if I could ask the Lynchburg City Schools Education Foundation Board of Trustees to please stand. Thank you so much. I would like to ask my bosses, the Lynchburg City School Board, to please stand. Mr. Charlie White, the chair, Trinae Tweedy, the vice chair, Marianne Barker, Al Billingsley, Dr. Gina Dolan Sewell, Troy McHenry, and your friend and mine, Marie Waller. And the Lynchburg City Council and the City Manager, we'd love for you to please stand at this time. Mayor Joan Foster, Councilman H. Carey, Councilman Michael Gillette, Councilman Randy Nelson, and is that it? Don't let me forget anybody. And certainly our very able City Manager, Mr. Kim Payne. And from Representative Bob Goodlatte's Lynchburg office, is Clarkie Epps here? Yes, thank you so much. It's my pleasure now to introduce our Virginia Teacher of the Year, Meg Smith. Recently, Charlie White, Al Coleman, Brian Ray, and I went to Richmond to see Meg honored by the Virginia State Board of Education and also by the General Assembly. And also at which time Brian Ray tried to take credit. We managed to straighten him out on the way back. But I'm so thrilled to have made the acquaintance of Meg Smith. She's a 17-year veteran teacher. She's our Virginia 2012 Teacher of the Year. She's an eighth grade English literature teacher at Paul Lawrence Dunbar Middle School for Innovation. She earned her Bachelor of Arts degree in history with a minor in art history from the College of William and Mary, a Master of Education degree with an emphasis on curriculum and instruction, and a Master of Education degree in educational leadership from Lynchburg College. She's made numerous contributions at the school and division level. She currently serves as English Department Chair a participant in the iPods and Instruction Grant Initiative, a regular education lead teacher for the annual Virginia Grade Level Alternate Assessment Program, a co-teacher in an inclusion classroom, and a member of the Lynchburg City Schools Gifted Advisory Committee. She's also served as a head mentor at her school, a cooperating teacher for area colleges, as an adjunct professor and clinical faculty member at Randolph College, during which time she created and taught a course for pre-service teachers. When asked what her platform would be as Virginia's 2012 Teacher of the Year, Mrs. Smith said, "I want to remind people of all the dedicated teachers, fantastic students, and meaningful moments happening in Virginia's public schools every day. I want to encourage everyone in the Commonwealth to learn more about and help support and improve our school system and its over 1 million students. In summary, I invite everyone to celebrate and strengthen Virginia's public schools. Let's celebrate Meg Smith."
Thank you. Good morning, and I am very honored to be the 2012 Virginia Teacher of the Year, and it's very humbling to represent not only my colleagues in the Lynchburg City Schools, but the over 71,000 public school teachers in the Commonwealth. And as you already know, because Dr. Massey just told you, as I travel throughout Virginia and beyond, my platform is to encourage everyone I meet to celebrate and strengthen Virginia's public schools. So I want to begin by thanking each of you for your support of public education. There are currently 55 million students in our nation's public schools. That number is projected to rise to 58 million by the year 2019. So this predicted growth indicates that we will soon need more teachers and additional resources in classrooms across the country. However, the economic downturn that has challenged your businesses has negatively impacted school budgets as well. Across the Commonwealth, tens of millions of dollars in operating revenues have been slashed. Both personnel and instructional resources have been significantly reduced. And this pattern of deep cuts is likely to continue. And unfortunately, as you know, Lynchburg City has not been immune to these financial woes, and the school board is going to likely have to make additional reductions again this year. So that makes the support that you provide all the more important. We in the Lynchburg City Schools have incredibly valuable partners in the business community. Your monetary support allows us to continue much-needed remediation and enrichment opportunities, and your donations of time to mentor students, to support our programs, and to spread positive messages about our schools are equally important. You need to know how truly, truly grateful we are for all that you do. We couldn't do it without you. We are committed to helping all of our students acquire the skills and knowledge they need to go on to be productive, responsible citizens and to realize their dreams. Your support helps make that goal a reality for our students. I would like to ask all the educators in this room to give one more round of applause for our community partners. And now for the body of my talk. So I was asked to design an activity for you that would demonstrate teaching excellence. Well, and it was a daunting task for two reasons. Generally, instead of 30 minutes, I have about an hour to deliver a lesson, and thank goodness my class size has nowhere near this many students. But I'm glad to try as long as you agree to participate along with me. Thumbs up, are we good? All right, that's what I want. All right, okay. First, I want you to take just a moment to think of a favorite teacher you had from when you were growing up. Now, you will probably remember that teacher as much for how that teacher made you feel as for the content you learned. Good teachers recognize the importance of forging positive relationships with students and for creating classroom climates that facilitate an active learning partnership between teachers and students. We summarize this idea for new teachers sometimes in, students won't care how much you know until they know how much you care. So effective teachers also have a lot of other important characteristics. They give and earn respect. They manage their classrooms in firm but kind manners. They know their content well, and they have high expectations for their students. And dozens of professional development workshops have been designed that revolve around each of these characteristics, but I'm not focusing on any of them. What I'm focusing on today is creating lessons that require our students to actively engage in the content, because we have to get them engaged in order for them to acquire the skills and knowledge they want. So it may be hard to believe, but not all of our students come into class every day motivated and willing to work. So therein lies one of our primary challenges. We have to design lessons that draw the students in, and then we have to require them to be active participants. And so today, you as my students, we're going to engage together in a mini lesson. Just one single technique that I hope will demonstrate to you the idea that teachers have to be creative to get our students to engage. And remember, you are my students, and as I always tell my students, failure due to failing to try is not an option. So we all did the thumbs up, we're good. All right, so in every content area, whether it's math, language arts, science, history, music, PE, drama, you name it, students need to learn vocabulary. So your lesson today is a vocabulary lesson. First, I needed to find some words that hopefully you wouldn't know, so I chose some lesser known phobias. So here's our objective for the day. By the end of the lesson, you're going to know the definitions of the words and then be able to use them effectively in written and oral communication. And I'll have to trust that you'll do the last part on your own outside of class. So to accomplish this objective, first I'm going to have you work independently for a few minutes, and then you're going to share some of what you've done with your table group. And then lastly, be ready, because I want a few people that will share with our entire class. So that I'm looking for volunteers there. So rather than simply having you read the words over and over again, or having you repeatedly write the words and the definitions, I'm going to have you become more engaged with the vocabulary by having you interact a bit more with the words. Now, on your table is a manila envelope, and it says, please do not open until instructed. At this point, if somebody at that table will please open it up and pass out to everyone a paper and pencil. All right, as you are finishing up, so you know, the room has been divided into three sections, and there's this side, the middle, and that side. Each section has some different words. And your sheet is formatted like this. So this is my example slide. So in the center box, you have the name and phonetic spelling of a phobia. Mine's oclophobia, and you can see the phonetic spelling. In the upper quadrant, you see a definition of your word. And in the lower left-hand quadrant, you see a connotation of the word. And since we're talking about phobias, the connotation's obviously negative. Plus, you have the word's etymology. If we had more time, these would be boxes that I would have you research and fill in on your own to get that aspect of the learning, but we're abbreviating it. So for about the next 3 minutes, you're going to work independently to accomplish two tasks, and I'm going to model those tasks for you so you can see better what to do. In the upper right-hand quadrant, you're going to make a drawing that will help you remember the word. So here's mine. So you can see I've got, mine's oclophobia, it's a fear of crowds, so I have my crowd, and then my little man, help, a crowd, and he's running away. All right, and I always tell my students, because I actually have my students draw for vocabulary, it doesn't matter if you're a great artist, and it doesn't matter if the drawing doesn't work for someone else, if it works for you. In the lower right-hand quadrant, you're going to do one of two things, your choice. You're either going to describe a movement to represent the word and definition, or a brief poetic memory device. So again, my word is oclophobia, and mine is making an O for oclophobia. Oh no, a crowd! And then I run away. That's my movement. Here's my poetic memory device. I created a little rhyme. Oclophobia, O-C-H-L, when being in a crowd is like being in a place that makes you nervous and panicky and stuff. So remember, you're only required to either do a movement or a poetic device, although if you have time, you are welcome to do both. Now, I want you to be creative and have fun. There are no right or wrong answers. You're creating something that works for you. Begin. All right, if you will come to a conclusion here in the next moment, and I appreciate how diligently you worked on that. There was some noise, but like sometimes we have noise in classes, it was productive noise. Don't worry if you didn't finish. Sometimes some students need a little extra time, and if you didn't finish, you're welcome to take it home with you and finish it at home if you would like to. So students often comprehend what they do better and are able to remember better when they're able to share their thoughts and ideas with other students. So for the next 2 minutes, and our fine timer, Dr. Sullivan, we'll do that one, I want you to share around with your table group at least one of what you did, one of your devices. So now share for 2 minutes. If you will draw your conversations to a close. All right, back this direction. All eyes this way. We're refocusing here. The last part is going to require me to have 3 brave volunteers because I'm going to ask a volunteer from each section to share just one of the memory devices you came from because there are 3 words and each section only had one. When you share your memory device, it can be any of them, including we have an airliner, which is something that if you choose to do your drawing, will allow your drawing to be projected up. So the first group had the word ergophobia, which is a fear of work. Some of you may have that occasionally. do I have a volunteer by hand in section one? We got one right here. Stand up, and are you doing your drawing or because we've got a mic too. We're gonna mic you here.
Ergophobia, fear of work. Got the principal here at Tri School. This is a picture of our building falling down.
What he's using is called an airliner. It's something we have available to our students that allows us to be able to take something to them and what their work to be projected up without them coming up. It is difficult to use. It's a little.
What I'm trying to draw is this is an ergophobia. I'm yelling urgent, and that's campaign on the other side.
Awesome, thank you. The second group in the center had ketophobia, which is a fear of hair. I've got a volunteer already. Hang on a second. They will bring you a mic and an airliner.
I probably don't need a mic. I'm the principal at T.C. Miller Elementary School. We are ketophobic in this section. We are fear of hair. We have a fear of hair. So if I'm ketophobic, I won't be seen by Aquanet, L'Oreal, or Accrochine. Catch you later. I'm out with Mr. Clean.
And finally, our last group had ophidiophobia, which is fear of snakes. This is very, you know, a lot of people have this one, snakes or reptiles. Volunteer in group 3. Got a volunteer.
All right. This is our poetic memory device. Snake, snake, go away. I want to mow the lawn today.
There we go. Thank you so much for your work on this. You did a fantastic job with the activity. And again, these are the kind of things we do with kids. And this is just a single example of how teachers have to think creatively to help our students engage in the content. If you have chances to visit classrooms, and I really encourage you to do so, you will no doubt see a wonderful variety of innovative and effective strategies being used by skillful teachers throughout the division. And at this time, it's my pleasure to note that sitting among you are some of the finest teachers in our school division. These teachers were chosen last year to represent their colleagues as Teachers of the Year at each of their schools. They are what excellence in teaching is all about. When I call each teacher's name, I'd like for that teacher to stand at their seat, and if you can please hold your applause until we go through the whole list. Tracy Tassick, Bass Elementary. Cheryl Hughes, Bedford Hills Elementary. Monica Hendricks, Dearington Elementary School for Innovation. Tiffany Ellis, Heritage Elementary. Michelle Campbell, Hutcherson Early Learning Center. Karen Kohuth, Lincoln Elementary. Katie Rosevier, T.C. Miller Elementary School for Innovation. Kathy Malloy, Paul Monroe Elementary. Tracy Prophet, R.S. Payne Elementary. Emily Laybourne Morris, Paramount Elementary. Kay Allen, Sandusky Elementary. Natasha Yeoman, Sheffield Elementary. Deborah Fitzgerald, Lincoln Middle. Calvin Buck, Sandusky Middle. Don Daughtry, E.C. Glass High. Rick Duperier, Heritage High. And Brenda Miller, Laurel. Please join me in a round of applause for these outstanding educators. In conclusion, I want to thank you again, not only for what you have already done to support our schools, but for what you will no doubt continue to do. And on that note, I'm going to leave you with one final assignment. Please continue to keep your eyes and your hearts open for opportunities to celebrate and strengthen Lynchburg City's public education system. Now, more than ever, you are an essential element in Lynchburg City Schools' tradition of excellence. Class dismissed.
Don't get too settled. I need to call you back up. We're just about done for this morning, but first I want to thank Meg for showing us what it takes to be an outstanding teacher. Her passion for education and her commitment to her students clearly shines through. Cultivating teachers like Meg is what makes our public schools great and how the Lynchburg City Schools maintains its tradition of excellence. So Meg, if you don't mind coming back up for a second, we have a little something for you. Partly to thank you for all of your efforts in preparation for today. I know that you're trying to balance being a Virginia Teacher of the Year as well as still having a classroom. And also just as a little commemoration for your accomplishments as Virginia Teacher
thank
of the
you.
Year. So hope you enjoy.
Thank you so much.
Thank you. I again want to thank all of today's sponsors for supporting this breakfast, and to all of our contributors who support our foundation initiatives throughout the year. And I do want to add to our list of support of sponsors for today, WSET. Thank you to Dr. Ken Guerin for hosting us on his beautiful campus once again, and the catering team for getting 300 people through the food line in less than 20 minutes. So thank you for your outstanding service this morning. Please feel free to take one of the beautiful centerpieces home with you this morning. You may have to fight for them because I don't think there's quite one on each table for everyone. But please take them home or to your office to decorate that space. And all of these centerpieces are courtesy of our wonderful art students throughout all of the grade levels in our school division. I do also want to thank Cynthia Babb and Skip Wallace for documenting today's event, and Doug Wickham and Greg Sullivan to ensure that we had no technical glitches, which meant that I actually could sleep last night and not worry about setting up the PowerPoint and things like that. So that was great. Thank you, guys. So in closing, I just want to share a little story. My husband, Michael, and I became very good friends with a French family who lived here for the year and a half that our friend Philippe worked at Arriva. And actually, they chose Lynchburg. He actually didn't work for Arriva. He worked as a contractor. And they chose to come to Lynchburg because of that wonderful French school we have. So they're now back in Paris. but we managed to stay in touch via Skype. We were speaking to them a few weeks ago, and the topic of children came up. Our friend Philippe said in his French accent, and I'll try to capture it, "Je dis, the truth is in the children." The truth is in the children. A simple but powerful statement. The truth is in the children. A brighter world for tomorrow takes the hard work and creativity of our teachers today, but they can't do it alone. We appreciate your interest and commitment in our schools, and we urge you to please stay involved and spread the good word. Thanks so much for being here, and have a wonderful day.